Welcome to the Rosenbach Podcast. I'm your host, Alex Ames, Associate Curator of the Rosenbach Museum and Library in Philadelphia. This is Season 2, History Behind the Scenes, in which we explore the Rosenbach's remarkable historical, fine art, and decorative art collections, travel behind the scenes into the work of the institution to preserve its treasures, and engage in critical conversations about the place of rare books, libraries, and museums in modern-day American civic life. In this episode, part of our All the Single Ladies mini-series exploring women from the past who lived independent, empowered lives, we're taking a trip to Lancaster, Pennsylvania, to visit the home of President James Buchanan and his niece, Harriet Lane, who was the first hostess at the Executive Mansion in Washington to earn the popular title of First Lady. We'll join Ms. Lane and her uncle on their transatlantic voyages, consider Lane's life and work, and reflect on what her experiences reveal about gender and power in 19th century America. Have you ever felt like you've brushed up against history? Perhaps while watching a news report or attending a political or cultural event, you've had the sensation that you were witnessing something historic, experiencing history in the making. I think this is a sensation most of us have had once in a while in an indirect way. But for some people, events and circumstances conspire to bring them into the very heart and center of politics and culture, and turn them into historical actors, however unlikely that role may once have seemed. One such person, a woman who by virtue of a family connection found herself at the apex of American and British political and cultural life, was Harriet Lane, of Lancaster, Pennsylvania. Harriet Lane's life was defined by tragedy, remarkable opportunity, and continuous involvement with some of the most famous people of the 19th century. Born into a middle-class family in 1830 and orphaned while she was a young girl, she asked at age 9 that her favorite uncle, a man named James Buchanan, be made her legal guardian. That fateful request shaped the rest of Lane's life. Buchanan was a Democratic senator from Pennsylvania and loved his niece very much. As he ascended the United States political hierarchy, he brought Lane with him, introducing her to fashionable Washington society. As the bachelor Buchanan's roles became grander and grander, Lane took on the work of his official hostess. She accompanied Buchanan when he was appointed minister to the court of St. James in London, where she became good friends with Queen Victoria, received invitations to teas and other society events with great regularity, and turned away prominent proposals for marriage from well-connected Englishmen. After her uncle's election to the presidency, she became his official hostess as sectional divisions in the United States worsened and laid the groundwork for eventual civil war. When not in Washington, Lane and her uncle lived at an estate called Wheatland in Lancaster, where I am sitting today to learn more about Buchanan, Lane, and this remarkable First Lady's foray into the history books. I've been thinking a lot about the U.S. presidency as of late because I'm working on an exhibition at the Rosenbach set to launch later in 2023 that will consider the history and future of the nation's executive office. Learning more about Buchanan and his family seems like a wonderful entry point into many of the critical issues we will want to consider when exploring the place of the presidency in the national imagination. I'm joined for this conversation by Patrick Clark, director of the Wheatland Estate. Thank you, Pat, for hosting me today in the reading room at Lancaster History's library and for telling me more about this fascinating piece of Pennsylvania and American heritage.
Oh, you're welcome, Alex. Thank you for inviting me to be on your podcast.
So tell me a little bit more about James Buchanan, just to sort of set the stage for the significance of the particular story we're going to tell today. Tell me about the man, his public life, and his legacy.
Well, let's start with the man. He, like all of us, starts out as a young boy that are on the male side of the coin. Buchanan was described by many who knew him growing up as a very precocious young man. His father was an Irish immigrant, came over from Donegal before the United States became the United States. His mother, a little more difficult to research, but Elizabeth Spear was supposedly from somewhere in Lancaster County. But when James Buchanan Sr., let's call him, met Elizabeth, she was living with her father and her brother, taking care of the house. Her mother had passed away, so Mr. Spear was a widower. James Buchanan Sr. asked her to marry him and brought her to a place of business that he had purchased after having worked there for a while at South Mountain. Today we would know it as a little town just south of Mercersburg, kind of a blink your eye and you're through it. And that's where James Buchanan, the future president, was born. But before he was born, he had a sister who was born there. But she died a couple of months before James's birth. He was the, let's say, the oldest surviving of 11 children. And his rearing by these two individuals really kind of sets the tone, like it does for all of us. His father was a very conservative Presbyterian, and his mother loved poetry and all things about learning. And I think that's where he gets this instilled in him. His public life begins here in Lancaster, comes to Lancaster with his parents' permission to study law. And he has a very deep fascination with law, so much so that some say he was more married to law than anything else. He reads law as a young man and passes the bar in 1812. In 1814, 2 years later, he's 23 years old, and he's out on the streets of Pennsylvania and delivers his first public speech. And part of that speech is to sort of rally support among the young men of his generation to defend the United States. The War of 1812 is on, and Baltimore is being attacked. And Buchanan was one of the first ones to volunteer his time. So he becomes a part of the early militia movement. And later that year, it wasn't a long, hard-fought battle, but he does go to Baltimore and returns. And then in October of 1814, is nominated by the Federalist Party to become a representative of this region in the state legislature. So that really kind of begins his public life as a politician. His political career is really kind of troubled, and I think the troubles begin more so with his last 4 years in public life as president of the United States. But his he's got a long career in both the legislature, starting in 1821, and going through his years as a U.S. senator, which kind of come to an end in the year 1844-45, when he becomes the Secretary of State for President Polk. Prior to that, under Andrew Jackson, James Buchanan serves as a foreign minister, a diplomat in Russia under Andrew Jackson's administration. And then later on, as you've mentioned in your introduction, when he loses the opportunity to achieve the presidency in 1852, Franklin Pierce, as president, appoints him as the minister to Great Britain from the United States. And that leads up to his presidency. And his presidency is on the coming of the Civil War. Of course, none of them knew that. They feared it. Mm-hmm. I think you'd have to be living under a rock in those days to not know that there was severe unrest among the people of the United States. But Buchanan had spent 3 years out of the country leading up to this time. And I think that sort of lends to his sort of misunderstanding of how serious things had gotten in the United States.
So you think if he had been local, shall we say, he might have had a better grasp on.
Maybe a slightly better grasp, but keep in mind, Buchanan is a real dyed-in-the-wool conservative. And in that regard, he doesn't have a very open mind to really appreciate what people are saying and feeling.
Sure.
He seems to have more alignment, you might say, with the Southern gentleman and that culture that all that entails. You know, he grew up in a household where his mom and dad owned the time of blacks who were owned by somebody else. They were paying for that time. And we know this through advertisements in the Franklin Repository, which was the local newspaper of the area in Mercersburg. When his father places an ad that he has a Negro boy who still has time to serve. And so he's not selling that person, he's selling the time, which is just as bad, but in our morals, but in their time, that was an acceptable thing.
Right. He was essentially very much caught up in unethical, you know, right. culture of enslavement,
exactly.
economy of enslavement.
Exactly. Servitude.
Mm-hmm. Servitude.
Yep.
So much has been made of Buchanan's bachelorhood over the years. Can you tell me a bit about the context of gender culture in which Buchanan found himself immersed in the mid-1800s as he's really rising to the top, the pinnacle right. of American social life? What would have been the stereotypical notions of masculinity in his era? In what ways did he or didn't he abide by them? And then give me a sense of how this became something that was talked about in the press and in popular culture.
Yeah. Well, Buchanan was a bachelor, a lifelong bachelor. We know through hindsight as 21st century Americans. If you think back to the first quarter of the 19th century, when he's really come of age, really, by the time he's 30 years old, it's the late 1820s, actually the early 1820s for that age. He had attained a net worth of $300,000
wow.
by that time. That's roughly equivalent to a little over $6 million in today's money. By the standards of the time for masculinity, James Buchanan had made it. You know, he was an incredible breadwinner, if you think about it that way. And that was part of the whole concept of masculinity, to be a solid, upstanding citizen. Did you have a good standing in society? That comes around for Buchanan not too much earlier than his engagement to the first woman he would be engaged to, Ann Coleman. That occurs in 1819. Only a year or two before that, his good friend who introduces him to Ann, Moulton Rogers, who is kind of a quasi-law partner, is a second-line signer for James Buchanan to join the Freemasons. So he becomes part of this huge fraternity that so many American males were members of. And that plays a big role in Lancaster society back then. So James Buchanan is hitting all of those benchmarks to be a classic contender for a good, supportive, and loving husband. He is accepted by this young woman, Ann Coleman, who agrees to marry him. He's thrilled with it. He leaves on his sojourn, his annual sojourn in the summertime, to go off on vacation for about a month soon after their engagement is announced. But he comes back to a very busy time, and there's a misunderstanding between him and Anne that, frankly, none of us in the field of history have been able to figure out exactly what happens. But the historic record does show that she goes off to stay with her her sister in Philadelphia soon after she breaks off the engagement with Buchanan. And Buchanan's distraught. He doesn't know what to do. He writes her lots of letters to get her to change her mind. But unfortunately for us, the historic written record, it doesn't exist anymore. Mm-hmm. All that we know of is a letter that he writes to Mr. and Mrs. Coleman asking permission to come see her earthly remains after she dies in Philadelphia in December of 1819. The letter was never opened. So he doesn't get a chance to go to the funeral or to the wake. And Buchanan kind of hides for a while in the community, doing his work as a lawyer. And then his friends kind of gather around him during the next year or so. And he turns to politics again. And he runs for national office. And now he's elected to the House of Representatives, where he will remain for 10 years. Unprecedented for a Lancaster representative to be in the U.S. House for 10 consecutive years. So James Buchanan does sort of hit all of these right things, as I say, early on in his life. And by the time you get to the middle of the 19th century, let's say it's the year 1850, right? Mm-hmm. He's an old man. Mm-hmm. I've made a note to myself. In the early 1840s, he's pursuing two women in the Kittera family in Philadelphia, but nothing seems to come of it. And he writes to his friend Eliza Blair in early 1840, and he says, "I believe a bachelor becomes more and more undecisive as he grows older." What a statement. Wow. I don't quite know how to take that, but it is what it is, you know. And I looked at that letter in a broader context, and it just seems that he's resolved that he's going to be a bachelor for the rest of his life. So I think that James Buchanan kind of handles that well, but, you know, it reemerges during the 1856 campaign for the presidency. The Republicans use it in some of their ways of attacking the Democratic nominee for president. There's a wonderful image of old Jimmy B sitting in a room holding an old suit jacket, basically a sack coat of the mm-hmm. time, and it's all got these patches all over it. And of course, they're wonderful patches. One of them says the Ostend Manifesto on it. And they're using this to sort of paint this picture of an old bachelor. Mm-hmm. Is he someone you can really trust with the future of your nation?
So certainly in our modern society, you know, we look back and view it through an LGBT mm-hmm. lens. And I know that Buchanan did have a very close relationship or a very close intimate friendship with
William Rufus King.
Right, with senator, if yep. I recall. That some today have speculated perhaps that was what we would consider a queer relationship or a romantic sure. relationship. But what I'm hearing you say is that we have to try to view these issues or view his life through the lens of the society and culture of his time and place him within his own context, which was clearly he was devastated by one mm-hmm. heterosexual relationship mm-hmm. that was dissolved.
Sure.
Never married again, was labeled a bachelor mm-hmm. in his own time. How, as a historian and someone who interprets Buchanan, for visitors today who might come and not know much about him, but maybe have heard that component of his mm-hmm. life, how do you encourage people to make sense of Buchanan in that regard?
Well, that's a tough thing to do. I think it's difficult for us to think about the past because we have a hard time disassociating ourselves with our own time that we're living in. Mm-hmm. I can't remember which historian said it, but the past is a foreign country. Yeah. And I think that's very true. It's also very difficult for us to look at the written historic record and try to psychoanalyze someone, try to figure out their sexual preferences, mm-hmm. when oftentimes we're only looking at maybe one side of the conversation. Mm-hmm. Tom Balchersky, who spent a little time with us here on an NEH fellowship, has come and done wonderful presentations for us in our lecture series. Tom is the author of a book called Bosom Friends, The Intimate World of James Buchanan and Relationship Between James Buchanan and William Rufus King. Tom has, it seems to me, in, after reading his book, his thesis seems to point out that Buchanan really kind of used his relationship with William Rufus King as a ruthless politician. Hmm. When King wanted to have the friendship, Buchanan was willing to exchange friendship as long as he got what he wanted politically. And when King wasn't there anymore, mm-hmm. or had weakened in his position, Buchanan just kind of blew him off in some ways. I can see Buchanan doing that, having read a number of his letters. Mm-hmm. He's somewhat cold and calculating in that mm-hmm. way. Some of the dislikable traits of a politician.
Sure.
And I don't know enough about William Rufus King to speak about him, but Tom also theorizes that it seems as though King had the tendency to maybe be wanting that relationship to be more than it was. Mm. And so there's, you know, sort of a belief, or at least a theory on Tom's part, that perhaps that was the side of the relationship that may have had a tendency to maybe fit our sense of a person from the LGBTQ society sure. of today.
Sure.
Yeah, there's something about Buchanan that's very mysterious. You know, even some of the historians that I've met and worked with in dealing with Buchanan, just trying to get a handle on what was happening in those 4 years between him and his cabinet members, mm-hmm. but they never kept records mm-hmm. of some of their more important conversations that they had as cabinet members. And therefore it makes it really difficult to figure out, you know, was he competent mm-hmm. at being president, or was he a puppet?
Yeah.
In some instances, through his 4 years serving as president of the United States, you can clearly see that James Buchanan was not in charge, mm-hmm. but instead his cabinet members were in charge.
Wow. Well, I think your comments just go to show a number of things, one of which is how complex each and every human being is.
Yeah.
And number two, how our understandings of things that seem so basic as attraction or mm-hmm. relationships are really shaped by society.
Right.
And in the 19th century, the early to mid-19th century, was such a time of shift, shifting understandings and of sure. gender and class and
right.
even things like romance and mm-hmm. The nature yeah. of social relationships, that it's in a way not surprising that we have a rather inscrutable figure on
right.
our hands here.
Right.
Really interesting.
Yeah, I think that if Buchanan had lived past the years 1868, had he lived into the decade of the 1870s, I think society would have been harmful to him because they would have become much more vocal about, you know, old bachelor, you know, because the word bachelor becomes something nasty
sure.
in society.
Really interesting. I'm definitely going to have to check out that book. It sounds like a great read.
Great book.
So let's turn now to the actual main focus of our discussion today, Harriet Lane. Please tell me a bit more about her. Who was she, and how did her life intersect with that of James Buchanan?
Well, Harriet was the sixth of seven children to Elliot Toll Lane and Jane Buchanan Lane. Jane was 2 years younger than her brother James Buchanan. She was born in Mercersburg. They lived in Mercersburg in a house that Elliot's brother Thomas had built. Interestingly enough, right across the street from her grandparents, James Buchanan and Elizabeth Buchanan. Harriet's childhood is, you know, a bit sketchy because we don't have a whole lot of written documentation about it. But later in her life, she was still alive, certainly right up until the early 20th century. But there was a historian writing about the first ladies in the 19th century, during the late 19th century. And that historian approached Mrs. Rebecca Shunk, who was a cousin of Harriet's. And she described Harriet as a mischievous child, overflowing with health and good humor. Mm-hmm. So I think Harriet is a fascinating individual. She had to deal with so much. I think you mentioned that in your introductory notes to your podcast. As a very young child, I forget how old she was exactly when her older brother died, one of her older brothers. And then she was, I believe she was 5 years old when her younger brother died. Mm-hmm. And we are not 100% sure of what the cause of death was for those two boys, but we suspect that it was what they called consumption. Sure. We would call tuberculosis today. We do know that when she was 9 years old, her mom died of tuberculosis. By this point in her life, her family life, it was really only Harriet and her older sister Mary who were still living at home in Mercersburg. The two older boys that survived, Elliot Eskridge Lane and James Buchanan Lane, were both living in Lancaster County, both actually in Lancaster City. So the two girls were still at home with their father when in November of 1841, Elliot Toll Lane passed away, their father. And to the best of our, we can tell from primary documents, Edward Y. Buchanan, who was an Episcopal priest, the youngest sibling to the president, the future president, arrives in Mercersburg and takes possession of the two girls, his nieces, brings them to his home in Paradise, Pennsylvania, where he and his wife and their four children at the time, they would later have six more children. So the two girls joined their cousins and their aunt and uncle. At some point, again, written information is so sketchy at this stage in her life, but we do know that she sent, along with Mary, to attend school in Lancaster City, run by two sisters, old maid sisters, so to speak, the Mrs. Crawford. And Harriet bristles that she has to attend this school, apparently. We think that it's at this time that she comes to request that she be put under the guardianship of her Uncle James. Her cousin, James Buchanan Henry, is already living with James Buchanan. And it's not here at Wheatland. He doesn't become the owner of Wheatland until 1849. Harriet and James Buchanan Henry, Buck Henry, as we call him, they're living in his home, which is down in literally the heart of downtown at the corner of Christian Street and King Street, not too far from Duke, right across the street from Buchanan's favorite store, the Demuth Tobacco House, where he had a running account for his cigars and chewing tobacco. So I think it's right around age 11 that these two truly intersect, and this relationship that was formerly niece and uncle becomes more like father-daughter. Mm-hmm. We know that within probably weeks after this new relationship begins, that Harriet and Mary are sent, taken out of the Crawford's school, and they're sent over to Lidditz to attend the female seminary there, which later becomes a school that is still running in Lidditz. Can't remember the name of it, though.
So the Mrs. Crawford ended up playing a key role in American history.
I think so.
If Harriet hadn't been bristling at the thought of being there, maybe she never would have asked to go into the Guardian.
Probably so. Probably
really
so.
Fascinating. Yeah. So we talked a bit about how, I guess, as her uncle's political fortunes rose and he became more and more prominent in national civic life, she, as I guess the female head of household, in a sense, took on hostess roles and became this key figure in helping him present himself to the world in a way that would have been expected of a formal, 19th century society.
And she's being trained to do that in all of these schools. I mean, the last school that she attends is the Catholic school run by the Visitation, the Order of the Visitation. The nuns, Catholic nuns, who are running a school in Georgetown. Okay. And she's 15 years old when her uncle transfers her from a very fine school in Charlestown, Virginia, which is now part of West Virginia, and she ends up in Georgetown. Mm-hmm. Much more convenient for James Buchanan. His niece is there in Georgetown, and she can come visit with him at his residence in Washington, D.C. on the weekends. And in fact, we know that this is where Harriet starts to become much more politically aware. She is a witness to this powerful senator, actually helping to probably be somewhat of a little hostess alongside Miss Esther Parker, who was Buchanan's housekeeper in Washington. We know that Esther catched the train in Lancaster and could be down in Washington 8 hours later to serve as the hostess for dinner parties. And in fact, when Harriet is serving as the hostess of the executive mansion during the White House years, when she goes off to travel, who ends up serving as the substitute hostess of the White House but Esther Parker?
So it's almost like Buchanan had to create a sort of household for himself that would enable him to live in the way that other, dare I say, other married senators.
Other married people would do it, exactly.
Wow, so interesting. So tell me about the time that they spent together in London, because if it's not amazing enough to think of Harriet Lane going from basically a middle-class family stricken by terrible tragedy to the heights of life in Washington. She's also experiencing the very summit, the pinnacle of British high society at the time.
And she falls in love with British society, unlike her uncle. James Buchanan does not like living in Great Britain, but he knows that she's got these high expectations. In fact, I picked out a quote that he writes to her saying that I am sorry, truly sorry, that you look upon your trip to England as the, quote, future realization of a beautiful dream. Like all other dreams, you will be disappointed in the reality. But she sees it as the pinnacle of her life at that point. And what young woman wouldn't like to go to a foreign country and have everything, especially the queen of that country, be there to greet you? Harriet is actually expecting, as it does occur, that she will be given diplomatic clearances. So she wants to study French, which is the diplomatic language, and make sure that she is fluent in it. Mm-hmm. And I chose another wonderful quote from a letter. She must have written, unfortunately, we don't have Harriet's letters because she destroys most of them at the end of her life. But you can hear her saying, I'm going to do this. Mm-hmm. And he replies, I do not think well of your going to Philadelphia to learn French in the house where James Henry boards. Clemmy Pleasanton writes me that they will do all they can to instruct you in speaking that language. You will be far better with them than at a French boarding house in Philadelphia.
I mean, those French boarding houses have a reputation. So.
Yes, they do. Oh, my.
Huh. So, she knew what he was doing. Harriet Lane was cognizant of the opportunities with which she was being presented.
Yeah, she was getting ready to go to be introduced to English society. Her uncle prepared her to be introduced to American society by sending her to these wonderful boarding schools. And from 1849, when they move into Wheatland, she graduates that year from the Catholic Visitation Convent School. And that winter, see, in American society, the society seasons of parties, which a young debutante, frankly, like Harriet, would be expected to attend, begin in the winter months, late fall, early winter, and continue and end in spring. In England, they begin in spring and continue into the summer. And then the fall and winter, everyone goes out to their country estates and live their lives out there. So Harriet was in heaven. She arrived in April of 1854, and her uncle greets her at the docks and brings her to his home that he is renting. And we know that she meets the Queen of England. We're not sure exactly if this was the first meeting, but on February 17th, 1855, which is likely the first time she meets her, formally anyway, the Queen recorded in her diary, "Mr. Buchanan and his really lovely niece, Miss Lane, parenthetical note, very ladylike and not at all American."
Well, lucky for her, I guess.
Yes. "The Clarendons, Lord Harding and his son Arthur, parenthetical note, just returned from the Crimea." So you know what's going on in the world now, right? "The Gladstones and General Simpson dined. Mr. Buchanan sat next to me, and I found him quite agreeable." The reason I say that this is possibly the first time that Harriet meets the Queen is because this is possibly the first time that Mr. Buchanan dines with the Queen. Sure. We know that he meets her, but only a few months earlier. Mm-hmm. So it's very likely that that's the first time they meet.
Wow. And I mean, that's quite the compliment for the Queen to take notice and approve of this,
yes,
you know, orphaned girl from
Lancaster. Not at all American.
And not at all American. And didn't they become quite good friends, actually?
Well, they certainly communicate. We know that, you know, Harriet would have been much closer to Edward, Prince Edward's age. She was much older than him, but much closer generationally. We don't really have a lot of evidence, written evidence, of them exchanging an awful lot of letters. They don't meet again in person until Harriet is a much older woman and a widow. So it's not until around the year 1896 or 7, Harriet takes a trip to England. And I found in the Queen's diary that she makes it, there's no interpretation needed. She says that I've just met with Mrs. Johnston, the former Miss Harriet Lane, who I have not seen since, and she mentions the 1850s wow, meeting between the two of them.
Think of all world history that had happened in between those two meetings. It's just incredible.
Now, she does meet up with Prince Edward in Paris. She's vacationing with her husband and her two boys, and she has two servants with her. In fact, there was a wonderful newspaper article that I had recorded for our conversation. See if I can find it here. But they had been traveling, and they had spent quite a bit of time in Paris, in France in general, and it was says here from this newspaper article, "During his short stay in Paris, the Prince of Wales took occasion to pay a visit to Mrs. Johnston of Baltimore, formerly Miss Harriet Lane, who was staying for some weeks at the Hotel Westminster in that city. The compliment was not only consistent with a truly royal courtesy, but was merited by the recipient, whose claim upon the recognition of the representative of the British throne was well established during the years that she presided over the White House at Washington and at the residence of the American minister in London.
Huh. It's just mind-boggling, really, when you think about it.
Yeah, it really is. I followed Harriet. I wrote a sketch of her life, and my intent was initially to provide our volunteers with a factual representation of her years at Wheatland. Mm-hmm. And Philip Klein, who wrote a biography of James Buchanan, and a relative of his, Frederick Klein, in their notes, exchanged letters back in the late 1950s trying to establish how much time Harriet spent at Wheatland. It wasn't much.
Sure.
She was traveling constantly. As I mentioned earlier, when she moves into Wheatland in the spring of 1849 with her uncle and her cousin and Miss Hetty, she's only there until the fall. Mm-hmm. And then she's off to Washington, to Baltimore, to Philadelphia, mm-hmm. to New York. Mm-hmm. She's constantly traveling,
right,
because she's a debutante. Mm-hmm. She's looking for her position in society.
Yeah.
She's been introduced.
So let's, on that point, let's go from her time in London, mm-hmm. as the minister's hostess, essentially,
yeah,
to her time in the White House. So she did refuse a proposal of marriage.
She did.
In London.
Yes.
Which I understand disappointed Queen Victoria.
Sir Fitzroy Kelly. It would be a catch, but he was 57 years old. And she was, what? It's 1855. She's 25 years old. Not unheard of, but yeah. Yeah, Queen Victoria was very disappointed. She was shocked, actually, that Harriet was not engaged, at least. She also turned down a congressman who had approached her while she was still living in the United States with her uncle, Job Tyson, I believe his name was. And he traveled, I might have that name wrong, but I didn't think to write that down. But I do remember he traveled over to Great Britain, and James Buchanan said that his letter to her brother, Eskridge, in 55 references that Harriet needs to make up her mind whether she's going to accept Mr. Tyson's offer of marriage or let him go. And clearly she let him go because she wasn't engaged. She would not be engaged until she decides that the gentleman that she meets while serving as the hostess at the executive mansion, mm-hmm. Henry Elliot Johnston of Baltimore, who courted her on a couple of occasions during those 4 years, reemerges in 1864 while she's at the vacationing up at the Bedford Springs Hotel. And she writes to her cousin James Henry and asks, what would you think if I told you that Henry Johnston has shown more interest in me again?
What do you think eventually led her to accept him? Was he handsome? Was he particularly charismatic? What was his
good question.
Unique quality.
Well, he was certainly well established. Going back to your earlier question regarding Buchanan, what were the benchmarks for masculinity and a good husband? He certainly was well established. He and his brother were heading up their late father's bank in Baltimore. So he was a very fine catch in that regard. Mm-hmm. I think their personalities meshed from letters that I've read from Buchanan when he becomes aware of her intentions to accept him as her husband. He points out that he has a fine personality and seems to be, you know, well established in society. Buchanan even invites Henry's sisters to stay with him at Wheatland, and writes to her. Apparently, Harriet didn't get along with her future sister-in-laws too well, but Buchanan thinks they're fine young women. Mm-hmm. So I'm not answering your question 100%, certainly, but it's
she seems to have made
a love match,
as yes. compared to
yeah, they're certainly interested in each other. Why him all out of all of them? You know, how maybe it was just the chemistry,
right?
Yeah,
as compared to a 57-year-old English baronet or knight,
and they were actually right next to each other. He was a year younger,
sure,
yeah. So they're really certainly of that same generation. Interestingly enough, though, he was certainly not too old to have fought in the Civil War, but we can't find any record of him being in the Civil War. There is a mix-up by some history writings that a Henry Elliot Johnson was fighting for the Confederacy and was captured and imprisoned. But that's Henry Elliot Johnson without a T, and from Maryland, but not from Baltimore.
Interesting.
So, yeah.
Important distinction.
He may have been wealthy enough that he bought his way out of the opportunity to fight in the war. That was been known.
So tell me more about what Harriet Lane, what role she occupied in the White House and what her time as the host, or I shouldn't say the White House, the executive mansion, well, what her time in the executive mansion was like, what role she played there.
Well, as the hostess of the White House, her job was to organize social gatherings. We know that I believe it was Tuesday, she held a soiree for a select few invitees to attend. And they were, you know, the 4 years under Buchanan, the White House came to life again. You have to look back at the 4 years prior, and poor Mrs. Pierce, she was in mourning. She had just witnessed her son, his death right in front of her eyes in a train wreck that she and her husband and her son were involved in. And then she had lost her other children before that. She did not want Franklin to go back into politics. And yet there he was accepting the presidency. So the White House had been a sad place for 4 years. And here you have this young 26-year-old, 27-year-old by the time she becomes the hostess. She made it so that this place came to life and was filled with fresh-cut flowers. She convinces her uncle to put a hothouse onto one of the wings of the mansion, so that she could have her variety of fresh flowers. You know, that's, you know, described in detail by her cousin in his biographical sketch of his uncle later in life. Buck Henry writes a sketch of his uncle and their roles, his role as the private secretary for the president and her role for making sure that this senator isn't sitting next to this senator. she had a pretty important role to play there because not everyone got along. It was, you know, we live in a divided nation today. I think they lived in an extremely divided nation. And we know that in the chambers of the Senate and in the chambers of the House, it wasn't unusual for fights to break out. Mm-hmm. So when they came to the White House for social affairs, Harriet was not going to allow that to happen. Mm-hmm. And that's a big role to have played.
Wow. So who first referred to her as First Lady, and why did that term stick?
That was something that I hunted for a long time. Mm-hmm. I had always read in different sketches, and I don't think there's ever really been a biography written about Harriet Lane, primarily because a lot of publishing houses refuse to publish anything unless it has a certain amount of primary source to refer to. But I came across in the Southern Sentinel newspaper on the 21st of March, 1857, where they referred to Miss Lane as, quote, the Lady of the White House. Mm. Why did it stick? I think Harriet was just this charismatic individual who, when she walked into the room, first of all, she was a fashion hound. Mm-hmm. She caught that love of fashion when she went to Great Britain, and she went over to Paris twice. Her uncle told her when she came over in 54 to bring your finest clothes, and she came over with, I forget how many, I think it was 3 or 4 trunks of clothes, and she only used Louis Vuitton trunks to travel. And she returned with over a dozen. Because when she was brought to affairs in the court of St. James, she had to have a different outfit each time. Mm-hmm. So she was there from April of 1854 until October of 1855. That was an awful lot of parties to attend. Two social seasons, and she spent the winter between 54 and 55 at, you know, landed gentry's country homes.
I understand that even this question could sound like I'm trying to caricaturize her as crafty, and I do not mean to do that. But surely she must have been thinking, or you would imagine, that part of the calculus here is rubbing elbows in certain circles, mm-hmm. that is going to enable her possibly to meet and marry,
sure.
into the English aristocracy, into the highest levels of American society. I mean, do you think she was? I'm sure she and her uncle loved each other very much.
Yeah,
and it was a remarkable opportunity for this woman.
Absolutely, and I can't tell you how many letters I've read written by her uncle saying that his greatest joy will be to see Harriet married.
Wherever,
as long as he is he meets certain standards. Mm-hmm. Yeah. He didn't care whether she married a Frenchman, an Englishman, or an American, as long as she was well settled. On the other hand, she was, she may have been thinking that too. I mean, certainly, as a society woman, a single young society woman, clearly by the standards of the queen, she wasn't married yet. And here she was in her mid-20s. Mm-hmm. She wanted to find someone too. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, go back to that little girl who had suffered so much death, mm-hmm. in her early life. She comes back to the United States in 1855, and she is reading a letter from her only sister, mm-hmm. who is traveling from San Francisco across the country to come visit with her, mm-hmm. and then to discover that she was dead. Another blow. They get into the White House in March, on the 4th of March, 1857. And earlier that calendar year, her uncle and her older brother Eskridge go down to Washington together on some pre-inaugural business. And they stay at the National Hotel. And both Uncle James and Eskridge Lane come back suffering from this mysterious illness called the National Hotel disease. And her uncle is being treated along with her brother by Dr. Fultz. We don't know what the treatment was, but oftentimes they were giving them, doctors were giving doses of like some sort of like a charcoal mixture with other things to whiskey and trying to kill off whatever it was that were causing the problems. Buchanan survives. 37-year-old Eskridge dies on the 27th of March at the age of 37. And then in 1863, her oldest brother dies. We don't know what he dies from, but he's not all that old either. Mm-hmm. Harriet Lane is worried about this old uncle. He's 65 years old when he's serving as president of the United States. He's 70 when he leaves, nearly 70. She doesn't want to leave him. And Buchanan writes and tells her, you know, I want you married. That will make me breathe easier. And he's, of course, he's ecstatic when she agrees to. She tells her uncle in 1865, you know, that I'm going to get married and Henry Elliott Johnston's going to be my husband. He was beside himself with joy. But again, even as an engaged woman, she's apparently writing saying, I don't need to leave you now. Yes, you do. So there's this exchange, this constant, I think of it as almost like this internal battle in her head, mm-hmm. an emotional battle. Mm-hmm. Do I leave him? Do I get married mm-hmm. and be happy? Mm-hmm. And she finally agrees that it's better for her to get married and have her joy and her life start. She was lucky she had kids.
Yeah. Although, I mean, I understand and agree with what you're saying. The flip side of that is clearly they had Harriet Lane and her uncle had a very close, warm, intimate, loving relationship, mm-hmm. which I'm sure stems from that moment when this 9-year-old girl was taken in by her favorite uncle.
Yeah.
So, you know, a huge amount of love there on both sides.
Absolutely.
And she enjoyed considerably more independence.
Oh, yes.
As the unmarried niece of the commander-in-chief.
Yeah.
Than she would have as someone else's.
Oh, absolutely. That public lifestyle was just amazing. Mm-hmm. You know?
I think that's what I'm so interested in, is that she had, and I haven't articulated it like this before, but she had a public lifestyle as a woman in an era when the only way to have such a lifestyle would have been to be the wife of a public figure. She had a completely different way of occupying a very vaunted position in American society while also maintaining her independence.
Sure. You know, in a lot of ways, she was a modern woman. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But there's an interesting letter that Buchanan writes to his friend, Mrs. Gwynne. I have to figure out who Mrs. Gwynne is mm-hmm. in sometime in the near future, but it's during the early days of the Civil War. Mm-hmm. So Buchanan's at home, Harriet's at home. They're both in this retired mode, mm-hmm. For Buchanan much more so than Harriet. But Harriet, I believe, was at the time over in Philadelphia visiting her uncle Edward and her cousins. And Buchanan writes to this friend, Mrs. Gwynne, saying that all social visiting is at an end. Men, women, and children are all engaged in warlike pursuits. Miss Lane seems to be quite contented and has changed her mode of life with remarkable facility. And he repeats that again in writing to a relative toward the end of the war, saying she seems to have just adjusted because she was this full of life and out there and wanting to party and dance until the sun came up, which he also makes note of the fact that his health was suffering because of it, because he had to be with her. Mm-hmm. And here it is, They've both left public life together. She seems fine. Mm-hmm. She seems content that she doesn't have to be going to all these parties all the time.
And at this point, she's not yet married.
No.
She's with her uncle.
She's with her uncle.
Here in Lancaster is where she's based.
Exactly. Yep. Mm. But there's not a whole lot going on. Of course, the war is on.
Right.
And we all read accounts of the early days of the war where, you know, especially at battlefields where there was like a hillside to watch, thinking, oh, well, this is kind of fun, you know, to watch these guys being killed. And they're thinking, oh, well, this will all end soon, mm-hmm. but it doesn't. But Harriet resumes her relationships with some of her society friends, Sophie Plitt in particular, and her husband, George, who is a gentleman. You know, when they're listed as gentlemen, you know, they don't take a 9-to-5 job, right? So she spends a lot of time in Philadelphia. She spends a lot of time up in New York with the Roosevelts. It's really not until toward the end of the war when she's summering over in Bedford Springs that we start to see this sign that she's really ready to settle down. And Henry has re-entered her life.
So it's almost like she saw her uncle to the pinnacle.
Mm-hmm.
She was right there supporting it, a part of it.
Right.
And then it must have been perfectly obvious that that chapter of his life was over.
It was over. Yeah.
And then she could start a new chapter.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
So tell me more about her life and her reputation and her national profile to the extent that there was one after her time as First Lady came to a close.
Mm.
It strikes me that just from the little I know of her, some of her most important contributions to American life came after her time in the executive mansion. Can you tell me more about sort of what social role, what civic space she occupied after the presidency of her uncle came to a close?
Her prominence in society and her contributions really become evident when tragedy strikes again, frankly. I mentioned earlier that Harriet and Henry had children. The oldest boy was born while James Buchanan was still alive, and he's named for her uncle, James Buchanan Johnston. And then in 1869, she gives birth again to Henry Elliot Johnston Jr. They called him Harry and they called the older boy Buchanan. And it really is during the mid to late 1880s, these two boys catch rheumatic fever and die from it between 1881 and 1882, within 13 months of each other, which must have been just horrific. And just as they were thinking that things were calming down for them, in early 1884, she and her husband leave Baltimore and go up to New York to stay at a hotel, and he comes down with pneumonia and is dead by the end of May. Just before his death, probably about a month or so before his death, she had decided that she was going to sell the Wheatland farm here in Lancaster. But it's after his death, when his will is read, that she discovers that he had put up a sizable amount of money to start something that I've got to guess the two of them must have been talking about with regards to the passing of their two sons and the really lack of pediatric medicine and research into pediatric medicine that was lacking in this country. And she combines a chunk of her fortune with her late husband's money to start the Harriet Lane Home for Invalid Children. That's what he wanted it called. And Johns Hopkins Hospital agrees to take on part of the expense to make sure that this happens. So that, I think, is a remarkable contribution to society. And it still is paying dividends. It's one of the earliest, I think it was the first really, to concentrate on pediatric care. Harriet inherited, like her cousin, they were both in Buchanan's will. He gave his brother Edward, Harriet, and James Henry, the way the will was written, the original will, they were to divide the estate equally between the three of them. Harriet wanted all of the art. There was there were two sculptures, two busts of Buchanan, and Buck Henry took one and she took the other. All of her art, busts that had been made of her husband and her, her uncle's bust, all of his art, all of her art, later in her life, she contributes all of that to the Corcoran Gallery. And she petitions by letter Congress to give serious consideration to starting a gallery of art for the American people. Now, it's the seed, right, that's planted. But I think that it's fair to say that Harriet Lane's seed mm-hmm. grew into what we know today as, you know, that National Gallery mm-hmm. of Art for America. Yeah, you know, so I think that that's a prominent role for Harriet, an incredible legacy. She also founded, through her will, she was inspired. I should first say that she was first inspired by the boys' choirs of Europe, and she felt that the church here in the United States that she belonged to, the Episcopal Church, should have great choirs for of little boys, and so she founded the St. Albans School for Boys in Georgetown, and the school was built on land right there at the National Cathedral, still going today, and a pretty remarkable school. The other role that she plays in society is she's that great person, that great woman who had once presided over social affairs at the White House. And in 1896, I should say 95, she finally decides to sell her home in Baltimore, and she returns to the town that she knew best, Washington. And that's where she would live out her life. And there are numerous newspaper articles where you see that, you know, Mrs. Johnston, the former, and it's interesting, they always have to reference that she's the former Miss Harriet Lane, who was the hostess under ex-president James Buchanan, which was a title, by the way, he hated.
He said, ex-president?
Yeah, he hated the term ex-president. He hated being called the former president. In his opinion, he always said to friends in letters that there's only one president of the United States, and mm-hmm. when you're no longer president, you should be resorting to Mr. or Dr., mm-hmm. whatever your title was when you were just a lay person. mm-hmm. But Harriet was constantly on, you know, invitation lists in Washington society, and particularly at the White House. I mentioned to you earlier before we started the podcast that she was very, very close friends with Mrs. Cleveland, and they were close to each other in age and spent a tremendous amount of time at the White House as a guest.
It hadn't occurred to me before we started talking about this, but her husband was dead by the time she returned to Washington and assumed this role.
She's a widow.
The entirety of her life in Washington as a matron of society was as an unmarried woman.
Yeah. And, you know, in a lot of ways, she was like Dolly Madison. There's a wonderful photograph taken by Mr. Woods, I believe his name was a photographer that was desperately trying to convince President Polk that he had to record everything about his presidency, his 4 years in the White House. But there's this great photograph just outside the White House. And in the center of the photograph, as you can imagine, is the president and Mrs. Polk. And standing behind the president is the Secretary of the Treasury, who would later be Mr. Buchanan's, President Buchanan's last governor of the fated territory of Kansas, Mr. Walker. And then there's Mr. Cave Johnson, who was the tall and gangly guy. He was the Postmaster General. A niece to Mrs. Polk, Harriet Lane, at the age of 15 or 16, and James Buchanan, who the photograph kind of, he's in the dark almost. It didn't quite capture him. But over next to Mrs. Polk is the former First Lady, Dolly Madison. As we know, as Secretary of State in Polk's administration, Buchanan took on the personal responsibility of organizing all of the former president's papers on behalf of the government. And he would send financial aid because Dolly was poor at some point in her matronly years, and Buchanan supported her. So here's this young Harriet Lane, and now she's in the same position that Dolly Madison, who was the other fabulous hostess of the White House. The only difference was she was married to the president.
Wow. Well, I feel like this conversation has given me not only more appreciation for Harriet Lane, this person who I wish all Americans were better acquainted with, perhaps they will be after this podcast comes out, but also a much deeper appreciation and understanding of the nuances of James Buchanan's life.
Sure.
I think so often we only remember one or two things about certain presidents or have one or two opinions about them. But I think what we see in this relationship that they constructed is something intensely personal based on their family circumstances and something that reflects on the world of gender, filial structure, class, and sort of the culture that emerged around political life in America in the 1800s. And it's just fascinating to get this really interesting glimpse into, you know, American and British, you know, high society by means of these folks from Lancaster.
Thank you for listening to the Rosenbach Podcast. Check back soon for another glimpse into the Rosenbach Museum and Library's remarkable collection of rare books, manuscripts, art, and artifacts, and for more fascinating conversations about history, art, and culture. To learn more about the Rosenbach, visit rosenbach.org. We host a variety of on-site and online events and public programs, and always welcome questions from listeners about how to use our collections. Our holdings are always accessible to researchers who make a free appointment to visit our reading room. The Rosenbach's community reaches all around the globe, brought together by our love for history, rare books, manuscripts, and the arts. I hope you will consider supporting the Rosenbach Museum and Library and this podcast by becoming a member today. It's one of the best ways to help us with projects like this. Memberships start at just $55 and give you access to everything we have to offer, online and in person. If you cannot make a financial contribution, please give our podcast a good rating on Apple Podcast or wherever you listen to help us build our audience. The theme music for Season 2 of the podcast is a setting of the poem Longings, written by poet, artist, and educator Nellie Rathbone Bright in 1927. Bright co-founded the Black Opals, a collective and literary journal showcasing young Black writers in Philadelphia in the late 1920s. The musical version featured here was performed by Yolanda Wisher, Paul Geis, V. Shane Frederick, Mark Anthony Palacio, and Sir Lance Gamble. I wanna flee to a cool the Rosenbach Podcast is supported by a grant from the Evelyn Toll Family Foundation. Thanks again, and I look forward to continuing our conversation about history on the next episode of the Rosenbach Podcast.
In the heart of me, drums in my ears, and my lips are wet with the tang of the sea.